Hello, everyone. Hope you can hear me fine. Oops. So, hope I'm not missing any questions here. Good. So, my name is Jan Kiska. I'm working for Siemens. You may have seen some talk of mine in the past already, and I'm open to take your questions. I'm seeing there's the first one. So, yeah, I'm taking the first question here. It's about real-time Linux, one of my pet projects. I'm dealing with it here for various reasons. And one of them actually is Xenomai, which I took over as a maintainer, I think 2 years ago already. The question was if Preempt.IT, when it's going to be mainline soon, will obsolete Xenomai. This is a long thing to answer. In a nutshell, that's basically why we are working on it. We don't think it's obsolete. There are different use cases for different real-time solutions, and we have solutions where we need Xenomai, and we have solutions where we need Preempt.IT. And one of the key points we see for Xenomai is that we are flexible in modeling also real-time systems which are not POSIX compliant. Another advantage is the clear separation between the real-time and the non-real-time world, or the Linux world, or whatever you call it. But of course, there are also downsides, and that's obviously in the separate maintenance of a kernel patch. So in a nutshell, I don't see that there's going to be obsolete soon. Yeah, there's another question in this direction. So he is asking if how we see Xenomai in the context of EVL. So maybe for those of you who don't follow this, what is EVL? EVL is the next real-time Linux co-kernel approach written by the former Xenomai maintainer and Philippe Jerome. So he was starting a new real-time co-kernel approach for the kernel, which has some similarity with Xenomai from a further distance, but has a new kernel patch. I don't see that this is, obsoleting one or the other, definitely. So it's an interesting approach to have a clean, rewritten technology. And we are trying to make use of this. So there's actually currently ongoing activity together with contributors, among them from Intel, to port Xenomai over the foundation of EVL, the Dovetail patch. So we will try to make the best of both and combine them, having existing Xenomai users ported over in this way and making use of this new architecture and the new benefits of the new architecture. So Drew is asking regarding how we can decide between using IPipe and when just native kernel in Xenomai 3. So there are two options with Xenomai. Actually, we can run also on a standard kernel or normally on a Preempt.IT kernel. That is the use case for that is emulating APIs, as I said, which are not POSIX compliant, provided internally Xenomai can map them on the POSIX APIs that we have in user space available. So a criteria obviously is that you are fine with the APIs available there and their properties. They can't emulate all the behaviors of pre-existing real-time operating system or older operating system. So this is a limitation, obviously, of not having a full control over the scheduler and all the extensions that we made with the kernel approach. So otherwise, I would say if you don't have a need for these APIs, you can also go directly for Preempt.IT. and not use Xenomai at all. So the Xenomai user space approach is for the case where you really want to have make use of specific APIs. So let's see. Next question is again regarding EVL. So saying is that EVL should be much easier to add to new hardware. There's, as I said, EVL and a dovetail kernel patch is a rewrite, making certain things easier and cleaner. However, it's still a new project, and we will have to see how maintenance works. In the end, there is a lot of similarity in the problems you have to solve that we had to solve in the past and we still have to solve in the future. If adapting to new hardware is actually going to be easier with the EVL approach is something, well, the jury is open for. We will see how this actually will work out. I have some, yeah, I see some benefits in certain things that EVL is doing. I also see some things which have to be solved again, like providing a real-time driver API because we have a different scheduler. We need a different API separate from the mainline kernel, and that basically makes hardware adoptions also needed by the drivers, and that may actually result in similar but in the end still same porting and maintenance efforts. So we will see. I mean, ongoing activity is there, and we will have to compare the outcomes with what we are doing so far, which is also not optimal, and yeah, then see how it evolves. So next question, staying here in the context, Drew, there are rule of thumbs for different ranges of latency and the solution on, let's say, modern ARM SoC is something like 10 milliseconds to 1 millisecond, normal kernel, 1 millisecond to 100 microseconds, preempted T 100 to 10 microseconds, IPipe under 10 microseconds. Well, obviously, this depends on this kind of scaling, what hardware you're running on. So if you're running on a very low end, almost below 1 gigahertz processor, which still exists, these ranges obviously shift. Xenomai does have a little bit of advantage in certain scenarios on certain architectures or performance processors over preempted T. A little bit. I wouldn't say it's factors of magnitude or orders of magnitude. But if this is really your key question, depends on the use case. I would not only make it on the latency scale. I would rather look at other aspects as well before choosing preempted T over Xenomai. So let's look for a different question. So Stefan asks, Debian seems to be more advanced than LBESA. Why not switch and stop both? So first of all, these are different approaches. Debian uses the approach to recompile a Yocto-like system, OE-like system from source code, which is not provided from the upstream project, but rather taken from the Debian packages. That's the primary approach there. Elba and ESA both built upon primarily the binary packages as they are provided by the Debian project. So the difference is already in that detail. That means that you can easily use with LBESA binary feeds from Debian upstream and also from other sources of Debian compatibility, while Debian itself is not compatible in all cases with the structure and the format of the original Debian packages. It's more compatible to the Yocto package structures and system structure. So this is a major difference, and what you prefer depends on your use cases of the scenario. You can strip systems more down with Debian than you can do with a Debian compatible approach. But there is an area where both fit well, and there's an area definitely if you come to complex, higher complex systems, where you benefit from having most of the system already integrated by Debian and the community behind it, and not having to remodel the packages. I hope I'm not switching too much the topics. That's the next questions are again Xenomai related. So Pierre asks, I noticed the Xenoma latency is higher when running on a system with UI. Where does this probably come from? So normally the problem comes not from interrupt management or something specific to the to the graphic driver. Well, there are might be graphic drivers which have a long interrupt off latency path, although that with Xenoma should be broken up. Normally the higher latency comes from hardware effects, that you have shared resources in the hardware that you cannot easily manage in software. And these shared resources basically block or delay your real-time work, even if it's just CPU bound and not have anything to do with the UI. That's the rule of thumb, generally the reason for having high latencies when UI systems are active. But again, it depends heavily on the architecture and things used there. So Drew asked about a use case, audio processing for a real-time system. So there's Bela Audio using Xenoma iPipe because they need worst case latency, which are, well, 190 microseconds and below on a Cortex-A processor. So do you think this could be achieved with preempt RT? Well, 90 microseconds on this, that's a TI, Citara processor, AM3, that's definitely in the range of the architecture, what the hardware can deliver. These systems, to my experience, are likely noteworthily faster with a co-kernel approach than with preempt RT. Although I have personally never tuned preempt RT on any of the system and can talk if this can actually be improved. But this is actually the area when your workload is close to what the hardware can deliver with a reasonable software stack. And Xenoma helps you to get over this. And preempt RT basically is too close to the border or actually violates the border. Then you are better off with a co-kernel approach with something like Xenoma. This is definitely a good case where performance comes into play. But normally, if you are close to the limit, you may have to trust the system so much that it's probably not a good idea to only rely on the software approach and think about also other alternatives and ways to avoid that you are too close to the border. Oh, hi, Tim. Tim Bird asks, upstreaming status of preempt RT. So CIP is currently managing two kernels for the long-term support, RT and non-RT. Will they be able to up to a single kernel per release in the future? Yeah, we are counting on this. This is also the reason why we are supporting the real-time project, that we only have to support one kernel in the future. Unfortunately, this won't be something coming soon, like 5.10. So probably another year. My feeling is that a year would be great and probability is likely higher, but it's not set that it's going to be even by the end of next year of having then everything in mainline. For CIP, if we follow a cadence of having every 2 year a new kernel, though this is not officially announced, so this is still something we are discussing. The next but one kernel might be an option for us to pick up preempt RT from upstream. That would be great. So I'm optimistic that the next or next but one kernel of CIP will then have also RT in the same code base. Yeah. So let's see. I try. There's another new guy on the list. The question is, can I get more information on real-time Linux topic? Yeah, obviously, but I guess this will blow up the talk if I provide it here. So there's great information around the real-time Linux project. So if you look there, I don't have the URL here handy, but if you look for the preempt.it projects and their resources, there's a lot of information for beginners. Obviously also the co-kernel approach like Xenoma and EVL have project documentation around it. Although some information might be aging, this is a general thing. But these are good starting points to look for specifically. And I think there was a talk these days also about how to write real-time applications over preempt.it. It's also a good starting point. that could be a good start to get started and look into how to set up those systems and play with applications. So, okay, this is one question. So RT, XenoMy operator T on USB is of no avail. Huh. Okay, so real time over USB. This is actually a quite old project of mine. Started together with back then a student at university times, and we actually made it work to a certain degree with USB 1 and USB 2 later on. So basically rewrote a core host controller driver for that time for XenoMy. To drive certain USB attached cameras, sensors, devices in a way that is more predictable than you go the normal USB stack. So technically it's possible. I remember that we run into a lot of fun effects. I mean, USB is in some details not completely deterministic, and you of course also depend on the end device. So yeah, it's doable. I wouldn't say it's something which can become commodity. And yeah, it's definitely way harder to change this in the mainline kernel if you want to do that, simply because the whole USB stack is not designed around real-time scenarios. So I hope I can have answered both of these. Oops. Oh yeah, I clicked too many. So I think, Tim, I deleted your question. Maybe you can bring it up again. Oh yeah, Frank noticed that there's also the information, of course, in the elinux.org wiki about real time. So it's also something important to notice. And the good old real time Linux workshops, they also have a lot of presentations and introductions. So I hope I find. Okay. Yep, we had this on elinux.org. You find a lot of information, not only on real-time Linux, actually, in general. So worthwhile to look at. So Drew, maybe you can bring back the context. The problem is I'm only seeing the unanswered question here. What are you talking about regarding summit on Friday? There's a summit on CIP on Friday. What summit do you mean? So there's a new question regarding what's the status of security isolation in embedded virtualization plans for next year. Security isolation, this is a general question. So I'm not sure if you're asking about a specific project, because there are many things, many hypervisor projects in the embedded space, and many of them targeting also security scenarios. So look around, the ecosystem is full of them, even the open source ecosystem. There's something like Xen, Acorn, people use KVM. There's a JDOS hypervisor that I'm kind of involved with. So there is a broad range of this. So maybe you can be more specific in your question and I can follow up on that. Yeah, all right. Drew said there is a real-time summit on Friday. Right. Yes, indeed. So there's a question if XenoMy could become possibly an official project for Linux Foundation. I wouldn't exclude this, definitely. And having a home for the project in a foundation might be an option. In general, the point is it takes a critical mass, so companies move forward and push it there. I'm not a fan of if for example, we currently as Siemens driving the project would just say, okay, let's put it on the Linux Foundation alone. So that would take at least a second partner, ideally a Linux Foundation member or active in this direction, to move the project forward. So definitely Xenomai, even if I'm maintaining now, is not a Siemens thing. It hasn't been and it will not be. So yeah, putting it under foundation helps or can help to make this clearer. It can definitely help to raise certain visibility. But in the end, it still also depends on companies moving forward and getting active also on the code. And in this regard, I really welcome recent contributions, not only of Intel, but also of them. There are many people now working actively on Xenomai than it used to be. So it's good to see that this is moving forward, and we'll see what comes out of this. So. So yeah, just again, the pointer to the real-time summit, so people can see this, maybe better in the chat than here in the question list on Friday. So let's see if I'm still might not be online anymore, I see. It's 10 past 5 here, so I might be the session might be over. So in any case, I can continue the chat here as long as it's possible, but it may not be broadcasted anymore. So Francois says that Power 11 has apparently noisy neighbor protection. Any plans to port it in Jailhouse? Well, so first of all, it would mean porting Jailhouse to Power. Actually, we do not really have that much use cases here around inside regarding Power architecture. There used to be some, but no longer. So yeah, if someone is interested in bring this forward, I wouldn't reject a Power port. So for example, we are currently working on RISC-V ports, but this is probably something that we wouldn't drive. But yeah, the community is open for these kind of contributions. But in fact, nosy neighbor protection is something which is not only in Power 11 architecture. There are other architectures also providing this to different degrees being adopted. Okay, so yeah. Thanks, I'm done. Thank you, organizers, for making this possible. I hope I could address most of the questions. So if you want to reach out to me, just use the chat afterwards. I'm around here. With that, thank you. Bye-bye.